looks like most of us are in. That join code will stay up there. You've got a little bit of time. One thing I need to make sure that we did actually talk about, because I blew through this or blew past this in at least a few classes. Yeah, so the last thing, if you go back to, see if you don't mind. It's going to be at the bottom of page 29. The plantations were most successful in Ulster. That very last blank, again, at the bottom of page 29. Now, that's important, too. One, I don't want you guys to have stranded blanks left in your notes. But Ulster is this part. Ulster is what we will see become Northern Ireland. So making sure that you know those two different names for the same place is an important thing for us to do. Now we'll get back up to where we need to pick up. We left off talking about 1916 being an important year for two reasons. One, on Easter 1916, Irish rebels tried to overthrow the British government in Ireland, not the British government in the entire United Kingdom, but in Ireland, in Dublin, and they failed. During that same year, we have the Battle of the Somme in the summer of 1916, and in that battle, we have the Ulster Division of the United Kingdom's Army. The Ulster Division was mostly a Protestant unit. And that's because, remember, Protestant plantations were most successful in Ulster. And so most of the division drawn from Ulster is going to be Protestant. Matter of fact, I'm calling them Protestant Irish to kind of keep things a little simpler for us. There's enough things to get confused by in the Irish conflict. But what you're going to see later is a lot of the Protestants that live in Ulster or Northern Ireland don't really see themselves as Irish. They see themselves as British first. But for now, we'll just call them Protestant Irish. And in the Battle of the Somme, about 2,000 Protestants are killed, and about 3,000 are wounded. And all of that happens within 2 days of fighting in the Battle of the Somme. And this is one of the things that happened a lot to the British in World War I. It happened to other countries too, but they tended to draw entire divisions from the same place. So if there was a St. Joseph division and we happened to get thrown into the Battle of the Somme and 5,000 people were killed, that's going to be a huge chunk of the young men from a single community. And that's the kind of thing that happened in World War I. So this is
a traumatic event for Ulster, and it's one that they memorialize. You've got things like this banner in memory of the 36th Ulster Division, Battle of the Somme, 1st July, 1916. And the Irish Catholics also memorialize things like the Easter Rising in, well, among other things, in songs, right, that would be sung at pubs, to help people remember what had happened, right, and stir up Catholic feeling. Now, given these two different events in the same year, do you think that Protestants and Catholics quite likely remember 1916 in different ways for different reasons? This is just a quick pulse check on your opinions. There are no right or wrong answers here. Although actually it looks like what I'm seeing on Wyatt's computer, you guys can't answer yet, because Pear Deck's not playing nice. Now you guys should actually be able to answer. We'll just take 15 seconds out of this 30-second timer. All right, and if those of you responded, we are unanimous. Yes. Now, there really are no right or wrong answers, but most likely, Protestants and Catholics are going to remember 1916 in very different ways. They will both have their heroes, whether it's the rebels or the Ulster Division soldiers. And they're going to be very different in the sense that the Protestant heroes died fighting for the United Kingdom, and the Catholic rebels died fighting against the United Kingdom. Events like this help kind of drive the wedge further between Protestants and Catholics in Ireland. After World War I, remember, World War I concludes in 1918. Between 1919 and 1921, the Irish fight a war for independence. Now, this is independence in that true sense. This is a war to break away from the United Kingdom, like the United States or like the American colonies broke away from the British in our own War of Independence. The two sides that we've got are the Irish Republican Army, which is Catholic. Whenever you hear Irish Republican Army, we are talking about Catholics. And on the other side, the government of the United Kingdom, the Army of the United Kingdom, and the Ulster Police, which is a Protestant police force. That's why I said knowing what Ulster means is very important. As a result of the War of Independence, Ireland is split into two separate Irelands. We have Northern Ireland, which is Ulster, and we have everything else in the south. Now, this is done lots of times in history, dividing something up in order to resolve a conflict. What happened in Vietnam, it's what happened in Korea after World War II, and as we're going to see, it is not often successful. Both parts of Ireland, Ulster or Northern Ireland and the South, are going to remain as what are called dominions of the British Empire. This means they will have home rule, that thing that the Irish had wanted in the middle of the 1800s. And so they'll have self-government within their parts of Ireland, Ulster and the South. But both have to remain loyal to the British monarchy. That doesn't mean that Irish Catholics are required by law to sing God Save the King, but it does mean they can't rebel against the monarchy. They have to follow the laws of the British government. I remember when we say monarchy in regard to the British world, it's talking about a king or a queen. In this arrangement, Protestant Northern Ireland, the Protestants at least, and the Protestants are the dominant group here, want to remain and do remain close to the United Kingdom. Because again, lots of these Protestants don't see themselves so much as Irish as they do British. And it makes sense. A lot of them are the descendants of those English and Scottish plantations. The Catholic-dominated South gets a new name. It becomes known as the Irish Free State. And all of this happens via what's known as the Anglo-Irish Treaty. Hey, Anglo always refers to just English, kind of like the Anglican Church refers to the Church of England. So if you're wondering who those Anglos are, that's what that means to the English. But as I said, dividing a country in two to resolve a conflict often is just a recipe for a future conflict. Oh, this is brown. Yeah, I've been bad about that submit button today. I will get that done, Ms. Schaefer. Thanks, bye. You guys have work you have to get done. Teachers do too. Sometimes we're better at getting it done than others. All right, I'm going to multitask here. All right, we get a civil war in the Free State. So this is specifically a conflict that is happening within that southern part of Ireland. And that means that this is a conflict of Catholics versus other Catholics. We have two sides, much like we had before. Long names, but at least it's a simple one side versus the other, pretty much. We have the pro-treaty and the anti-treaty sides. The pro-treaty group is led by the government of the Free State. That's people like Michael Collins, who was known as Big Mike. He was very tall. And then on the other side, and these two used to be allies together, but now they're on other sides. On the other side, we've got the Irish Republican Army, and its leaders is Eamon de Valera. The IRA are fighting because they aren't satisfied with being a home rule dominion. They want full independence. The Free State supported remaining as a home rule dominion within the British Empire.
the Free State, oddly enough, is backed militarily by the government of the United Kingdom. So, same military, same United Kingdom that the leaders of the Free State government had been fighting against a couple of years ago are now being supported by that military. And that helps us understand the difference between the two forces. This photo is of soldiers from the pro-treaty Free State government side. They've got uniforms, nice equipment. They've got trucks to get around. They've got better weapons. And then on the other side, we have the Irish Republican Army. It's a ragtag bunch. They don't have uniforms. They fight in their own clothes. They scrounge weapons where they can get them. One of the things I want you to think about is this question. Considering the Irish Civil War within the Free State, is this evidence that Ireland's conflict is motivated by religion or motivated by something else? I know you guys don't need much time to think about that. I don't want you to stew about it too long, so when this timer hits 15 seconds, I'll be closing it down. All right, and by a little more than 2-1 margin, you guys went with something else. For those of you that went with religion, that doesn't mean you're wrong. But if we look only at this, and we have Catholics fighting against other Catholics, that suggests that there's probably something else going on. If it isn't religion, and even those of you who thought it was, if it isn't religion, what other thing do you think it might be? And here there are definitely no right or wrong answers, as long as you guys are giving me your honest effort. Okay, we've got some excellent answers. Might be land, money, politics or power, control of government, which is another way of thinking about politics or power. Certainly related to independence, and we could keep going on. Those sum it up. Okay. Now, for those of you that went with politics, right, I know I said there are no right or wrong answers, but quite likely politics is the primary motive in the Civil War. Now, previously, we have defined politics, right, as how groups make decisions based on ideas, interests, and power. Here we're going to use a simpler definition, and it's probably my favorite. Who gets what, when, and how? Now, to unpack this, we have to learn some new vocabulary. First up is nationalism. Nationalism is feeling a loyalty to and or a pride in your nation. That's different than patriotism. And patriotism is more about being loyal to a political thing, like a specific country or a specific government. But nations and countries aren't always the same thing. A nation is simply a people who have a common culture and a shared territory.
If you're thinking that sounds like the definition of society, it is. Nations are a form of society. And very much in this time period, something related to nationalism is an idea called self-determination. You're going to get to learn much more about this when you get to U.S. history and learn about Woodrow Wilson and his 14 points after World War I. We're just going to focus on one of those 14 points, and it's self-determination. This is the idea that nations should be able to form their own independent states. So, for example, the idea that the Taiwanese, who see themselves as distinct from people on the mainland of China, they should be able to have their own independent Taiwan, and China shouldn't be able to continue to call them a renegade province. Or maybe that the Quebecois in Canada should be able to have their own independent country. I mean, they have a national identity as the French descended Canadians. They have their territory. There is a province called Quebec. Self-determination would be the idea they could have their own country, right? And that they should have it if they want it. And when we talk about independent states, we need to be careful, because in the U.S., when we think of a state, we probably think of Missouri or California. Not the same thing. When you see state in this sense, you would usually call it a country. It's a people and a defined territory that is ruled by a sovereign government. Does Missouri have a territory? Can you find Missouri on a map? Is it like, are there lines drawn around it to tell us where it is? Yeah. Does it have a government? Yes. So why aren't we a sovereign state? No, that's not it. I heard that, Lexi. It's not that. No, it's that our government isn't sovereign. Our government can't do whatever it wants to. The sovereign government of the United States is the federal government with its capital in Washington, D.C. That's the difference. Missouri can't do whatever it wants to. It's sovereignty that makes the difference. And so, I know you guys are just so thrilled about getting to learn all of this new, exciting vocabulary. All right, sovereignty is a legal concept. It means that the government of a state is the final and ultimate authority over what happens in its territory. And you do need to understand it as a legal concept, because in practical terms, some states are more sovereign than others. Nobody's going to invade the United States to tell us what to do. But right, if you are a smaller country, right, that maybe we're thinking about things the way Lexi does, maybe a poorer country that's not as powerful, then it's more likely that if you do things that powerful countries don't like, they will violate your sovereignty. But legally, every state has it. Doesn't matter how small or how big that country is, legally it is sovereign. Now a little bit of a break from definitions to the outcome of the Irish Civil War. Free state wins. That shouldn't be a real surprise. They have all of the military backing of the United Kingdom. Whereas the Irish Republican Army, they can only have what they can scrounge. As a result of the Free States victory, Southern Ireland is going to have home rule, and it will govern itself, but it will also remain as a dominion within the British Empire. Now, as is often the case in history, after different groups of humans have fought bloody fights over something, things end up working themselves out on their own. That's not quite, that's an oversimplification. But what I'm saying here is, whether you were fighting for independence or for home rule, in 1937, the Irish Free State becomes independent, becomes the Republic of Ireland. And the Irish Republican Army becomes an illegal organization in both the Republic of Ireland, the area in green, and in Northern Ireland, which has remained part of the United Kingdom. Now our attention will shift to Northern Ireland. It's going to be our focus. Northern Ireland remains divided. On the one hand, you have the unionists. And here I'm not talking about like trade unionists like the United Auto Workers or the Teamsters. This is more like unionists in the sense of the American Civil War. People who want to preserve the Union. They are mostly Protestant. And the union they want is the union with the United Kingdom. They want to stay as part of that union of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. On the other side, you have the nationalists, people who view themselves as part of the Irish nation, not the United Kingdom, right? The British nation. These are, as you might have guessed, mostly Catholic. And really, when I say mostly, that's probably an unnecessary hedge on my part. When anybody talks about these, they talk about the Protestant Unionists and the Catholic Nationalists. There is very, very little overlap between the two religions and the two groups. And the Nationalists want to break away from the United Kingdom and join the rest of the Republic of Ireland. All right, we are going to stop there with our notes. At this point, please head back for the exit slip. If you missed something after you finish the exit slip, let me know. I'll run it back to a different slide.